We want to invite all of our guests to come, just come and stand around us and flank Dr. Forbes, Dr. Blackman, good friend Peter. I want you to know also that Dr. Forbes has served professor at Union Theological Seminary and has been listed as one of our nation's most senior pastors, Reverend Tracy Blackman. Been a tremendously important part of the movement in Ferguson and across this nation. And we gather here this morning. You have the declaration, you should have copies of it. We've already sent it electronically to the RNC. We will be doing the same thing we're doing here today at the DNC. And we represent now more than 1,200 clergy signatures and growing across this country that have signed on calling for both of our political parties to engage in a higher ground moral declaration. In 1967, Dr. King at Riverside Church, exactly a year before he was killed, declared that we needed a radical revolution of values in the face of classism, racism, and militarism. He said then that betrayal was silence. Silence was betrayal. And we declare that if silence was betrayal in 67, revival, moral revolution of values, moral revolution of values, revival is a necessity in 2016. Our country is in deep need, particularly in the public square. How what we call and what we list and what we deal with as moral values. I want to say something that might take the media for a little shock, but we're doing that intentionally because we have to recapture a lot of the terms that have been misused. For instance, I am a theologically conservative evangelical biblicist. That's the very reason I grieve, as do thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions possibly, when some attempt to suggest that the only moral issue is in the public square. Where do you stand against the LGBT community? Where do you stand for prayer in the schools? Where do you stand for poor property rights? Where do you stand on gun rights? Where do you stand in support of tax cuts for the wealthy? And when you take a position that says the moral position is to believe that the way to deal with poverty is for people to simply live right. The fact of the matter is, and I carry this Bible with me, the Poverty and Justice Bible is filled with Old and New Testament texts. And in it, you find that love, justice, mercy, equality, care for the least of these, and respect for the image of God in every person is the heart of true biblical, if you will, evangelicalism, or biblical public theology. There are over 2,000 scriptures in the holy texts, and that's not even including the Quran and other holy texts, that talk about how nations should lift up the poor, children, immigrants, strangers, women, the sick, the bruised, and any who have been made to feel unacceptable. These things are at the center of a moral consideration from a biblical perspective. In our Constitution, there are four great moral pillars: the establishment of justice, providing for the common defense, promoting the general welfare, and domestic tranquility. And that's why presidential candidates, Republican and Democrats, if you look back in history, whether it was Lincoln or Teddy Roosevelt, as Republicans, whether it was Roosevelt, later Franklin, and later Johnson and Kennedy, who talked about poverty and dealing with race issues and dealing with education and environment just as moral issues. One of our great American hymns says, America, God has shed his grace on thee. And then it says, God, mend thy every flaw, confirm thy soul in self-control. And then it says, because God has shed his grace on you, work until selfish gain no longer stains the banner of the free. We are delivering this high ground moral declaration because this left-right argument is too puny, too small, and too low. To guide America where we need to go, it just puts us in camps against each other. Liberal, this whole liberal versus conservative argument, where the term liberal sometimes is made a bad word to concern conservative. We believe that we're liberal and we're conservative. We want to liberally spread justice, and we want to conserve justice because conserve means to hold on to the essence of, and the justice is at the heart of our Constitution and the heart of our religious belief. Then how can one be a conservative if you're not trying to conserve justice for all? We have been locked into a linguistic trap. And this limited moral prescription of the so-called religious right and the so-called evangelicalism that many times even attempts to trick the media, for they will say the evangelical vote believes such a, but I'm an evangelical. Others are evangelical. And too often what we see actually is a theological form of malpractice, misusing the term evangelical, and then even getting worse when it calls itself white evangelicalism. Whereas Jim Wallace says in his book, Original, America's Original Sin, the emphasis is more on white than on Christian. We need a real moral revolution of values in our country and our public policy debate that is deeply moral, deeply constitutional, anti-racist, anti-poverty, pro-justice, and gender. We need a grown-up commitment to deal with data-driven reality of systemic racism and classism. We need a grown-up commitment to deal with the culture of violence, the culture. You know, Coretta Scott King was once asked about violence after her husband was assassinated. She said, well, wait a minute, poverty can produce a kind of violence. She said, I remind you, starving a child is violence. Suppressing a culture is violence. Neglecting school children is violence. Discrimination against working people, refusing to pay them a living wage is violence. Ghetto housing is violence. Ignoring medical needs is violence. Contempt for equality is violence. And then she said, even a lack of willpower to help humanity is a sick and sinister form of violence. We raised this moral declaration to say we're not interested anymore in this puny, small, anemic left-right debate that doesn't even fit now because it really comes out of the 17th century during the French Revolution. We're not in the 17th century, we're in the 21st century. And the reality is I just got on a plane and it needed a left wing and a right wing. What we're asking, what we're saying to political parties as clergy, this country is in deep need of prophetic and pastoral care. We need to deal with our issues from this perspective. Is this policy constitutionally consistent, morally defensible, and economically sane? And so inside of the moral declaration that now has been signed by more than 1,200 clergy, we declare that the deepest public concerns of our nation and faith traditions are how society treats the poor, those on the margins, the least of these, women, children, workers, immigrants, and the sick, equality and representation under the law, desire for peace, love, and harmony among all nations. We have five areas. One, true moral discussion. True moral commitment would be pro-labor, anti-poverty, anti-racist policies that build up economic democracy through full employment, living wages, the alleviation of disparate unemployment, a just transition away from fossil fuels, labor rights, affordable housing, fair safety nets for the poor, fair policies for immigrants, critiquing policies around warmongering that undermine our moral standing and ability to address domestic issues. Number two, education, equality in education by assuring that every child receives a high quality, well-funded, constitutional, diverse public education, as well as access to community colleges and universities, and securing equitable funding for people of color and of historically black colleges and universities. Number three, health care for all by expanding Medicaid in every state, assuring access to Medicare and Social Security, beginning with accepting the Affordable Care Act, but moving toward universal health care. And by providing for environmental protection and justice and protecting women's health. Number four, fairness in the criminal justice system by addressing in every area the continuing inequalities and brutalities in the systems that face that black, brown, and poor white people deal with, and standing against the proliferation of guns. And then number five, protecting and expanding voting rights is a critical moral issue, particularly here we are 51 years after the Voting Rights Act. We have less voting rights protection today than we had 51 years ago after coming across the Edmund Pettus Bridge. Protecting and expanding women's rights, LGBTQ rights, labor rights, religious freedom rights, immigrants' rights, and the fundamental principle of equal protection under the law. And we call on a resistance to the divide and conquer strategy of extremism. And we call for a moral agenda, a real debate around a moral agenda, both parties that deal with, and we have a grown-up dealing with, racism, classism, poverty, xenophobia. And we resent any attempt to promote hate toward any member of the human family. Let me now invite Dr. Forbes to come and share his remarks, following him, Dr. Tracy Plackman. Then we will go forward from there.
All Americans like to speak about the importance of their rights. A moral revival asks all Americans, have you considered the fundamental issue of right and wrong? The issue of right and wrong is a moral concern, and it's always more complicated when people, for whatever reasons, feel threatened in regards to their well-being, in regards to their safety, in regards to the prospect of a bright future for their children. Let me share that when we first started this moral revival, we had general concepts in mind, but contemporary events are making it very, very clear. A major right and wrong that every American citizen is going to have to deal with. As a minister, I preach inside about the king in 2 Kings chapter 7, who, when it was so bad in his country that mothers began to debate whether they were going to eat each other's children, he just got so frustrated. He'd been trying to do right, but looks like nothing was happening his way. And then something happened that's relevant to today and also relevant to our moral revival. He found Elisha and he said, the trouble we are in is from the Lord. And I've been trying to cooperate with the Lord, he seems to be saying, but he asked this question, which by the way, is a question that every American is being required to deal with. He said, why should I hope in the Lord any longer? And then he proceeded, get ready, to murder Elisha, the representative of the Lord. Now let me tell you something. That question, why should we hope in the Lord any longer, basically, can also be translated. Why should we hope that doing right, that doing justice holds a good prospect for the future of our nation? How long should we try to act democratic? How long should we try to do what's right? How long shall we try to be civil? How long shall we try to be respectful? But let me tell you what happened. That question was not just in the king. Sometimes what happens in the biblical world or in churches affects what happens on the street. Just the other day, a policeman crouched over a black man, had that question. How long shall I hope in the Lord? Why should I hope in the Lord any longer? And he pondered that moral dilemma, and then, bam! Just up in the suburb of St. Paul, a man, while a guy was reaching for his identification, the girlfriend says he has a weapon, but he's looking for it, but the policeman had in his mind, why should I hope in doing right any longer? Bam! Down in Dallas, a black man called Micah. Been listening to Black Lives Matter, listening to all this stuff, seeing what had happened, came to that moral dilemma. Why should I hope in right any longer? And bang, 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 bang. Why are we in a moral revival? Because the police departments that were trying to do right are asking, why should we hope in right any longer? Black Lives Matter, other groups seeing what's happening in the criminal justice system, asking, why should we hope in right any longer? Political leaders gather for conventions in Cleveland and in Philadelphia. Why should we hope in right any longer? We think that the question is precipitated by the complications of all sorts of rumblings underneath the earth we all stand, whether we're black or white or gay or straight or rich or poor or conservative or liberal or Republican or Democrat. The same ground is shaking. And when the ground shakes like that, question insinuates itself. Why should we hope in right any longer? We think that if we can get a moral revolution going, we may be able to say, you know, sometimes it looks bleak, but if you choose to do what is right, what is just, what is respectful, we want to hope together that in partnership with God the Creator and with brothers and sisters marching and working together, the prospect is likely to be better than bang, bang, bang. We need a revival.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Reverend Dr. Blackman.
Yes. Good morning. I am honored and very conscious that we stand here in the Amistad Chapel at United Church of Christ. The Amistad Chapel is made to remind us of the Amistad slave ship that marked a revolt that was successful and that the United Church of Christ helped in making so. The architecture of this place reminds us of what the slave ship looked like, but also reminds us of the resistance that it represents. I would suggest to you that we are once again in a time when we live in a nation that has shrouded capitalism in cloaks of righteousness, and we're pretending that it is so. We are once again in a time when right and wrong are not seen clearly. We are once again in a time where we actually have debates by people who have positions that guarantee them lifetime health care coverage about whether or not other people who have less should also have health care coverage. We live in a time where people are arrogant enough in the highest levels of our government to declare themselves to be pro-life and stop that argument with only the concern for women's bodies while failing to ban assault weapons in this nation. We are living in a time where people are hurting and are hungry and are homeless, and we have a government that says we should cut social services, that people should be able to make it on their own, all while denying that our government is one of the biggest social service agencies that we have. We live in a time where people are being given a false choice, a choice that says, if I am a Republican, then it means that I stand for what is right. And if I'm a Democrat, then it means that I stand for what is wrong. And I'm telling you that it doesn't matter whether you're a Republican or whether you're a Democrat, that the issue of two sides is a false one. There's only one side, and it's the side of righteousness. The faith community has been complicit in this cover-up. Our silence has contributed to the place that we are in right now. Our refusal to speak out across party lines, across racial lines, across gender lines, against what we know to be wrong. How do we know? Because we are willing to do for others what we do not do to ourselves. So I am honored to stand with these soldiers and the warriors from all over this nation who have said enough is enough. Here is the reality, my friends. There will be a revolution. It has already begun. The question is, are we going to be courageous enough to call into question a revolution that benefits us all? Or are we going to continue to be complicit in our silence and in our rhetoric with a revolution that will leave us all bloody? Thank you.
Yes, yes. Peter Morales, who is the president of the Unitarian Church, thank you for being here with us today.
It's an honor to be here. Sadly, we are reaping what we have sown. We have a system of inequality that is skewed to make the obscenely rich richer. We've seen the cynical use of racism by demagogues to divide our people. And we've been practicing human sacrifice. You know, we're appalled when we see images of other cultures practicing human sacrifice, yet we do it on a mass scale. We sacrifice elementary school children, people in Bible study, police that are protecting protesters, and we sacrifice them on the idolatrous altar of guns. I believe, I'm convinced, that we are better than that. We have to do what my good colleagues here are leading us to do. We have to get in touch with what we know and what we have been taught is fair and good. We need to search our souls, and then we need to join hands across all these lines, denominational, religious, class, race, join hands and recommit ourselves. And then we have to act together. My prayer is that this moral revival is the beginning, a first step in the salvation of this nation. Thank you.
Let me give just a few other remarks before we march down to deliver this Higher Ground Moral Declaration. We started in New York at Riverside Church, the same pulpit that Dr. King talked about the time to break silence. It was a time to break silence in 67, same weekend. We've now traveled to North Carolina, to Alabama. Here in Cleveland, we have 22 states we will travel to, holding moral revival services with Jews, Christians, Muslims, Hindus, people of faith, people who may not be of faith but who believe in the moral arc of the universe. We'll be at the Unitarian Universalist Society of Cleveland, 2728 Lancashire Road on tonight at 6:30. All of these revivals are live streamed around the country. It is a call to action. We are trying to make very clear that a moral focus is not just an emotional thing. It's not just let's come together and sing Kumbaya. Our Constitution says establish justice. Doesn't merely say be emotional about it. The Bible tells us in Micah, do justice and love mercy, not merely say it's a good thing. And those are declarations to society, to nations. We've lifted from our, we have Reformed Jews that have supported this effort, the Sam Proctor Conference, the Cairo Center at Union, the Auburn Seminary, Union Seminary. And when we lift these texts that speak to nations, for instance, Isaiah 10, it says, woe unto a nation, woe unto those who legislate evil and rob the poor of their rights and make women and children their prey. We have to have a conversation, not just about property rights, but about the rights of the poor. And so, in this declaration, I want it to be known that we're representing today more than 1,200 persons. Clergy from around the country and growing, and many, many others, lay people who are signing on. We also had a group of scholars, economists, political scientists that worked with us on putting together a moral agenda that's much broader than what's normally talked about in terms of a moral agenda. And inside of this agenda, are serious policy recommendations, policy demands. We believe that our debate has been too low. We need to move to higher ground.